This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Inside Abu Ghraib. Memoirs of two U.S. military intelligence officers. By William Edwards, Robert P. Walters Jr., and Paul Zanon. Published by McFarland & Company, Inc., Publishers. Jefferson, North Carolina. This audiobook has been produced using auto-narration tools provided by Google. Copyright 2021 William Edwards, Robert P. Walters Jr., and Paul Zanon. All rights reserved. Dedication. To the many family members who selflessly sacrifice and steadfastly support their soldier. Acknowledgments. A big thanks goes to Romeo Qureshi, Mickey Willems, Mike Flenty for taking the time to add some anecdotal color to this book, and to John Moore for facilitating the introduction between Colonel William Edwards, Major General Robert P. Walters Jr., and Paul Zanon. Special thanks to Nancy Walters, Daytona Erkin and Martina Malek, wife and daughters of General Walters, and Dana Edwards, Madeline Edwards and Elise Edwards, wife and children of Colonel Edwards. Last but not least, a special mention goes to Colonel Edwards and General Walters, from Paul Zanon for taking numerous months to recall one of the most poignant episodes of their lives so candidly. A note from the Department of Defense. The views expressed in this publication are those of the author and do not necessarily reflect the official policy or position of the Department of Defense or the U.S. government. The public release clearance of this publication by the Department of Defense does not imply Department of Defense endorsement or factual accuracy of the material. Epigraph. The soldier above all prays for peace, for it is the soldier who must suffer and bear the deepest wounds and scars of war. Douglas MacArthur. Preface. A good friend of mine approached me and said, "Paul, I have a friend of mine who is a former high-ranking U.S. Army officer called Bill, and he has a friend called Bob, who is also a high-ranking officer. They have served in Iraq and might wish to use their stories to form the basis of a book. I have no further information, as I did not wish to pry." I thanked my friend and contacted Bill. Writing a book is similar to a marriage inasmuch as you will be spending several months with the clients, and it's essential that you all get along and have a warm platform of communication. Before committing to any book, I always request to have an in-depth conversation with the client, just to gauge whether I feel I can work with them long term. In less than 5 minutes, Bill gave me the whistle-stop tour of his decorated military career, pinpointing some of the hair-raising moments from Abu Ghraib, and I instantly felt the sincerity and humility from the man. He then recommended a Zoom call with Bob. On a parallel to Bill, Bob radiated with that similar warmth and honesty, again, sharing a few moments about Abu Ghraib, which confirmed the solid foundation for this book. Putting aside the integrity of Bill and Bob, unique selling points are an essential factor of any manuscript. After shining a torch in a few corners and detailing a number of anecdotes which had previously not been publicized, Bob added one more gem. "Paul, there's a number of sources out there which always talk about the soldiers downrange. However, a unique aspect that needs highlighting is the role of the wives back at base and the effects on the families." Bob was right. I conducted extensive research, and this kind of information mainly came in the form of formal papers, presenting qualitative and quantitative data. In essence, with very little direct dialogue from the spouses and children. After those initial two conversations with Bill and Bob, I knew we had a lot of fresh material to bring to the reader's table. Working with military personnel has been a fantastic experience, as they would always assist in any questions I had, and any necessary bridges to facilitate peripheral interviews for research. It was essential to speak with certain key members of the 165th Military Intelligence Battalion, and more poignantly, Bill and Bob's families. Within hours of requesting a detailed conversation with any of them, either Bill or Bob had set up the line of communication. That primary research is essential in bringing unique content to the table, but also adding color to existing anecdotes. The writing process took around 8 months from blank page to draft manuscript. I hope you enjoy walking in the shoes of Colonel William Edwards and Major General Robert P. Walters, Jr., as much as I did. Paul Zanon. This book is a collection of personal memoirs from Major General Robert P. Walters, Jr., and Colonel William Edwards, presented with author Paul Zanon. Speaking in the first person in a candid and often raw form, Lieutenant Colonel, LTC Walters and Major Edwards, their ranks at the time of serving in Abu Ghraib, give their recollections of one of the most abhorrent prisons in history. Their narrative pulls no punches as it outlines their respective journeys to Iraq and their eventual deployment to Abu Ghraib in November 2003 under the banner of the 165th Military Intelligence Battalion. Assigned the nearly impossible task of improving the security posture in unfathomable conditions, LTC Walters and Major Edwards shine a torch in a number of previously untouched corners, sharing first-hand anecdotes of death, destruction, but on occasions rib-tickling laughter. With extensive input from their wives and daughters and a healthy involvement from a small selection of officers who served alongside them, their story will evoke emotions on several levels. The Protagonists. Boys to Men. Try not to become a man of success, but rather to become a man of value. Albert Einstein. Every soldier's route into the military is different. Many reach a crossroads in their life, some are inspired by their forefathers, others are a product of circumstance, and some just think, let's give this a go. What's the worst that could happen? Major Edwards embarked on a highly decorated military career after playing a few years of college football. That was my passion before I joined the Army. I was a pretty good wide receiver in a Southern California high school, and then went on to play for California Lutheran University, the school I was eventually recruited by. California Lutheran was not a Division I school, which was the level of league play that one would need to be considered for play beyond the collegiate level. I realized real quick that I wasn't going to be a professional football player when I got there. I reported into the rookie camp where they brought in all the freshmen, before they brought in all the sophomores, juniors, and seniors on the team. They brought us in a week early, and we had to go through a medical screening and all that type of stuff. I was about 5 feet 10 and weighed around 165 pounds at the time. I went to the physical test, and I was waiting in the lobby, and the doctor called me in and said, "Are you the new kicker?" I said, "What do you mean?" "I'm a receiver." He replied, "You're too small. You're going to get killed here. I need to speak to the weight coach because we probably need to put about 25 pounds on you so that you can survive." I played that year, left that school, transferred back to another school in Southern California, which was a junior college, and did quite well, earning recognition in the league. I was then recruited by another university at the Division I level to be a possession receiver, but I turned it down for my future career. I transferred to San Diego State University, which had about 40,000 students. I was walking past these white trailers on campus and there was a sign which said, "Army Reserve Officers Training Corps." I thought, "Him. I'm going to walk in here and see what this is all about." There was this guy named Captain Pete Ash, who is a good friend of mine to this very day. I walked in with shorts, t-shirt, flip-flops, and a backpack, and I said, "What's the deal with this Army stuff?" Captain Pete Ash said, "Take this Ranger handbook and read it. If you like what's in it, come and see me." I went home and saw it talked about rope bridges, jumping out of airplanes, and I thought, this is really cool. The next day I went back to Pete, and he put me in class. The rest is history. I never looked over my shoulder since. I joined the Reserve Officers Training Corps in 1987, at the age of 20, and then I signed my enlistment contract in 1988. Despite a rather laid-back initial approach to joining the military, with Edward's lineage, it seemed destiny was calling. My dad is retired Navy. He was enlisted for 20 years and finished out his career at Naval Air Station, Miramar, just outside of San Diego, and was teaching the F-14 Tomcat pilots the ground simulators. My cousin was a Marine in Saigon, Vietnam. My mom's brother, my uncle, was in Korea in the Army in the 1950s, and I had another uncle who was a World War II veteran in the Pacific. Also, my great-grandfather was a veteran in the Spanish-American War in 1898. So yeah. Maybe that walk past the reserve office's training corps wasn't a complete accident. It's a well-worn cliché, but behind every successful man is a strong woman. Edwards and his wife, Dana, first crossed paths in Berlin in 1990. I was studying at the time and he had just moved into the apartment building I was staying at, she recalled, but we never crossed paths or spoke. I remember my friend saying, "I think he's American and he's some army guy." Edwards added, "When I arrived in Berlin, the army was in stop loss, which meant no soldiers were allowed to move because of Desert Storm at the time. The unit was impacted because new people were arriving, but no one was rotating out, so housing was at a premium. The army was renting apartments all over the city to put us in a place to live, and I ended up sharing an apartment with a lab tech from our hospital out on the 1C Lake. It just so happened, Dana was living in the same building. The first time I saw Dana, she was walking past the American compound at Turner Barracks, and I said to a friend of mine, "That's the girl I'm going to marry." However, the first time I met her was at the German-American tennis club where she worked. Dana continued, "I was attending the Berlin Freie University as a student, and at the time I had a student job working for a German firm, which did security for the Olympic Stadium. However, the Berlin Wall had come down the year before, which sent unemployment through the roof, so when I went to renew my working permit, they refused. I didn't know what to do, so I went to the US consulate, and they said, 'Why don't you go to the civilian personnel office for the army and see if they have a job?' They gave me the address, and I ended up getting a job at the German-American tennis club, checking people in, that sort of thing. Bill played tennis, and he came in and started practicing with the tennis ball machine, trying to improve his strokes. He was regularly asking me out on a date, go to dinner, do something or other. I kept saying, 'No thank you, I'm not interested. No thank you.' He was so persistent, and my friend said, 'Go to dinner with him,' and eventually I agreed. We had Chinese food, my choice, and it turned out Bill doesn't like Chinese food, and despite him not liking the meal, we had a really great time. I totally misjudged this person who I thought I had no interest in. We ended up moving to Frankfurt, got married in 1993 in Denmark, and our daughter Madeline arrived shortly thereafter. LTC Walters had interests similar to Edwards at school, but his route into the army differed. I had a passion while I was at high school for football, similar to Bill, but when I finished my senior year, I knew I wasn't fast enough to go up to the next level. You had to be bigger and quicker. I was about 6 feet 2 and 200 pounds coming out of high school, but I just wasn't fast enough and couldn't jump high or anything like that. I knew I wasn't going to compete at the collegiate level. I did receive a 4-year reserve officer's training corps scholarship coming out of high school and went to the local college, Jacksonville State University, located in northern Alabama, and that's where I started going to college. What I started doing in college as a hobby was scuba diving. That was a big passion. Me and a couple of buddies did our open water diving in northern Florida in a crystal clear, cold sinkhole. We would dive there to get used to our equipment, the various depths, etc. Then we dived in the Gulf of Mexico. Then, during the summers when I wasn't in college, I'd be down in Florida, because I had family there in a place called Amelia Island just north of Jacksonville. I worked at a paper mill down there, because both of my grandfathers had worked at this paper mill. I was kind of a legacy now. There was no way they couldn't hire me for the summer. I had the worst job in the mill. The first summer, I was the janitor's assistant. Anything the janitor didn't want to do, it was like, "Hey Bob, I've got a job for you." When I had time off, there was this one specific retired Navy chief, and he loved to scuba dive but couldn't get his buddies to go with him all the time. This guy had a boat and a compressor in his shed where we could fill our tanks. We would spearfish, and one guy would carry a bang stick, which is basically a pole which has a shotgun shell or a 357 magnum shell at the end, and you would bang it up against the side of a big fish and it detonates the charge, and that charge went right through that fish. But that was only for protection, because we would fish for big grouper or snapper, and when you shot one of those with a spear gun, they don't die straight away, and they are not very happy about getting shot with a spear gun. As this fish is flopping around in the water and it's bleeding, that was a big attraction to sharks, and that's when the bang stick came into play, as you were making your way up to the boat. Unlike Bill, though, I dropped out of college and enlisted in the army. Joining the army was more of a case of necessity for Walters and his childhood sweetheart. Nancy and I met at high school in Kansas in 1977. It was at the Leavenworth High School orientation when they bring in all the new kids in the day before class starts, so we can know where our lockers are at, the classes, etc. Nancy was a sophomore, 10th grade, and I was a junior, 11th grade. That's when we started dating. Both Nancy and I were from military families. My dad was in the Army, and her dad was in the United States Marine Corps. He was in charge of the Marine Detachment of the Disciplinary Barracks at Fort Leavenworth, and the last thing Master Sergeant Peterson wanted was for his oldest daughter to be dating the son of an Army officer. I started out at the very bottom of the family totem pole. Then what happened was, my father moved away from Leavenworth, and we then all moved to Alabama. Nancy and I stayed in contact for about a year or so, then she dumped me. However, we re-established contact, got together again, and got married at sunset on Valentine's Day, February 14, 1981, in Alabama, on Cheeha Mountain, which is the highest point in Alabama. It wasn't an elaborate wedding by any stretch. My mother and father came over from Germany, which is where my father was stationed at this point, and one of my friends did the photos with a little Instamatic camera. I was still in college and Nancy traveled down to Jacksonville State, Alabama, and then we found out a few months later during that summer that she was pregnant with our first child, Martina. We didn't have any health insurance, so we went to the Blue Cross Blue Shield, which is a health insurance company in the States, which would insure college couples. When we explained that Nancy was pregnant, they said, "That's a pre-existing medical condition, so we can't help with that one." So I went from there to the recruiting station and enlisted in the Army, September 3, 1981. Martina is directly responsible for me joining the Army. I went off for basic training, while Nancy went back to her mom and dad in Kansas. I graduated from basic training in December and went back to Kansas. Martina was born on December 27, 1981, and my career progressed from there onwards. Introduction. A bad vibe. You have to remember that Abu Ghraib was a prison, but also a forward operating base. It had a wall around it just like a penitentiary, but inside there were concrete buildings with prison wings. That's where the U.S. Army Reserve Military Police Brigade was, and they were in charge of the prison detainees. Then there were some disused textile production warehouses, where the foundations of the looms were still in the concrete floors. This is where we, the 165th Military Intelligence Battalion, were set up. Artwork of Saddam Hussein in a disused textile factory in Abu Ghraib. The artwork was painted by facility staff under Saddam's reign, Romeo Karishi's collection. The reserve unit that had occupied the area lacked military discipline and had not done any appreciable work to the security or work to improve the living conditions of their soldiers. It was squalor. The discipline had completely broken down in that unit, so when we showed up in November 2003, they weren't saluting officers, they weren't properly dressed in military uniforms, and were not maintaining their weapons. It was a mess. The sanitary conditions were poor, everything was dirty, and weapons were totally clogged with dust. It was very poor organization. We were living in this facility, and about 100 meters away were thousands of Iraqi prisoners bunched in between a concertina wire fence. If they rioted or broke out, we were in the middle of it. It was a very tense situation. Abu Ghraib was a place where you could not live outside of a concrete building, because you would die due to the number of mortars and rockets. You did not hang out in the open areas. We occupied the buildings we needed to occupy to make sure our soldiers were protected. Overall, the place was very eerie. You were literally standing on the bones of dead Iraqis. So many people previously had been executed there, during Saddam Hussein's regime. The whole place had a bad vibe and had a cemetery feel to it, and that never went away along with the smell of the place. Mike Flenty, Assistant Operations Officer, 165th Military Intelligence Battalion. Prologue. Ambushed. Date, December 3, 2003. Location, Abu Ghraib. That day in December was no different from any other day in Abu Ghraib prison, Iraq, inasmuch as the blueprint for normality didn't exist in the first place. However, this particular episode made worldwide headlines as those involved demonstrated another level of integrity, loyalty, and pride at the drop of a hat. Major Edwards explained the context leading up to December 3, 2003. We'd been there for about a week. E Company, 51st Infantry Regiment, were conducting combat operations every day. In fact, in the time we were in Iraq, the 165th Battalion, specifically E Company, conducted over 400 combat operations. This is how those operations worked. We would send out a long-range surveillance team in about 3 or 4 trucks with machine guns on top, with each truck holding 4 soldiers, which included a driver, a tactical commander, and a gunner, who would be up there with a crew-served weapon. It's called crew-served because it requires 2 or more individuals to ensure it operates efficiently. Example of such weapons include the M60 and .50 caliber machine guns, anti-tank weapons, or anti-aircraft guns. A team of 3 long-range surveillance soldiers would be the absolute minimum in each truck, but technically, you'd have a 4th guy in the back to assist that gunner. The soldiers would then be inserted into a designated location in total darkness and would hide in the neighboring areas over a period of a day or 2, sometimes even 3. So you have to imagine, the patrols are moving at night in blackout conditions, in the middle of the desert or suburbs of western Baghdad, depending on the mission. Think about how hard that is. LTC Walters added. There was a place along the prison wall in Abu Ghraib where you could roll it back and slide these guys out, with minimal signature. If the enemy was surveying us entering the control point, we could slide these guys out the other entrance that we normally kept barricaded, and they would be under blackout drive, which meant their headlights and lights inside the vehicle were all extinguished. They would then proceed using night vision goggles while driving to the intended coordinates. On arrival, we'd do an insertion and drop off the team. They would then do an infiltration on foot to get to where their hide site would be, and from there establish a surveillance site a short distance away to counter indirect fire. Normally, they would put 2 soldiers up in the surveillance site, who were responsible for watching the area and identifying enemy personnel, combat activities. The guys in the hide site would be responsible for establishing communications and planning activities. We did an analysis of the points of origin where insurgents set up their rockets and mortars and had fired a few rounds at the forward operating base, and then broke everything down and drove away. Based on that analysis, you'd map some reconnaissance looking at overhead imagery to determine hide locations where we would insert the long-range surveillance team and they could conceal themselves. If the team were to see the enemy, they would shoot them or call for the artillery team. We did these combat operations routinely to try to mitigate some of the enemy's attacks on us over the current period of time and would coordinate with the other units in the area to improve the force protection at the operating base of Abu Ghraib. Major Edwards added, when it was time to exit, they would collapse the surveillance site and move any traces that they'd been there, relocate to the hide site, then collapse that site and do an exfiltration to the extraction point, where another team would come in with, once again, 3 or 4 gun trucks, extract the long-range surveillance team and bring them back to the forward operating base. That's kind of how it played out. Back to December 3rd. Late that evening, the patrol left Abu Ghraib in 3 vehicles. They were going to go roughly 17 to 20 kilometers south of the forward operating base from Baghdad to carry out a reconnaissance mission to obtain information about the enemy. Everything seemed to be fine. At this time, I'm at the Tactical Operations Center, TOC, around 10 p.m. to 11 p.m., in the area near where I slept, watching an episode of the TV series The Sopranos. At this time, it was late, and most people were in their offices or sleeping areas. Then the radio started crackling with chatter, with medevac, evacuation of military casualties to hospital by vehicle or helicopter, calls coming in. I ran into Bob's room and said straight away, "Something's going on in the talk." We got hold of the battalion operations officer and all went in there. Once we got everyone in together, the ops guys were taking charge of the long-range surveillance reports that were coming in. By now, the long-range surveillance guys who were on the ground were fighting, and when you heard the radio, you could hear 50-caliber machine guns and various other weapons going off. An infantry specialist at the time and some of the guys who were on the patrol were calling in requesting medevac because they were in contact with the enemy and had been ambushed. This specialist was about 20 years old, and bearing in mind the pressure he was under at that point, incredibly he wasn't screaming into the microphone. It was calm, controlled, and methodical communication. Prior to hearing his voice on the radio, Major Edwards had not crossed paths with the soldier, but LTC Walters had experienced occasional interaction with the young infantry specialist. He had been with long-range surveillance the entire time, participating in surveillance missions up at the camp in Balad, which was a little north of Baghdad. We were doing counter and direct fire surveillance missions, and he was on duty with other soldiers at the entry control point. My direct access with him was limited, due to the several echelons of command between us. He was junior enlisted, had a squad leader, a platoon sergeant, a platoon leader, a first sergeant, and a company commander between us. However, by this stage, we'd been deployed for 10 months or so, and you get to know your soldiers, simply because, when you are doing your battlefield circulation, popping into the entry control point, or taking a briefing from a team that's about to be inserted. So I had intermittent conversations with him prior to that night, enough to recognize his voice when he gave the report over the radio. Edwards recounted the memorable moment when challenge in the face of adversity became a life-or-death situation. We had a platoon from the 82nd Airborne Division living with us on Abu Ghraib. At any given time, you're going to have transient folks coming through and bedding down on the forward operating base, just to provide them with some security and rest prior to them continuing with their mission. The 82nd was attached to our battalion for a set period of time, but would be replaced. They were there to help provide security, mortar fire, and quick reaction force capability, and this was one of those occasions where all that came together in one episode. It was the middle of the night, and I ran into the living quarters and shouted to the platoon sergeant of the 82nd, "The long-range surveillance team is under attack. We need a quick reaction force team straight away. Can you guys roll?" He was sitting on his cot that he slept on and yelled into this dark warehouse where all these soldiers were asleep, "You guys get your asses up. Long-range surveillance is in trouble, we need to get moving." They were sleeping with their weapons and ammunition and rose instantly. They assembled their trucks in a really short time period, and we gave them a grid coordinate of where the ambush was taking place. Next thing, they were rolling out the gate going out from Abu Ghraib to help and support these guys. For me, it was one of those amazing moments, and since that time, I've been so proud to have been an American officer seeing this take form during combat operations. The ops team in the Tactical Operations Center was now supporting the medevac operation and the specialist. By this stage, he and his team was under fire and heavily outnumbered by 35 enemy insurgents, resulting in hits from 3 RPGs, rocket-propelled grenades, 3 IEDs, improvised explosive devices, and gunfire. Walters added, "In addition to everything happening in the middle of the night, detainee operations were still occurring in Abu Ghraib. We still had several thousand detainees inside the fenced area in tents, and high-value detainees, and interrogations were happening in the constructed jail or hard sites. That particular night, when I was alerted to the troops in contact, I was at the Tactical Operations Center listening to the radio. The long-range surveillance and insertion teams were dropped off, and the guys in the trucks were returning to the forward operating base. That's when an RPG came in and hit the right front tire of one of our vehicles, the vehicle the specialist was in. That particular round tore up the leg of the sergeant sitting up front that was in charge of that vehicle, and it also disabled the truck. That sergeant would later go on to die from those injuries several months later. When you're under fire, you return fire. During an ambush, you have your weapon system set up so that there's an ideal area that you can maximize the effects of fire on your target. Our guys were in the middle of that kill zone, and they had to push the disabled vehicle out. In the left front seat was the driver, standing in the center of the vehicle was the gunner, The specialist was in the back seat, and his sergeant, his boss, was screaming in pain because he just had his leg ripped apart from an RPG round. The specialist's fellow soldier had a 50-caliber crew-served weapon, and knowing this could be the key to winning the exchange of fire, he placed himself in front of the gunner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.